You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Hey guys, welcome. When I was a kid, this one was my favorite, so thanks for staying tuned through the entirety of Indiana Jones Month. Also, I haven't acknowledged this, but if you're listening to this and you're on the mission briefing feed, I thought these were kind of Bond-ish, so I put them out there. And if, yeah, obviously you're listening because you like James Bond, but you should listen to our other movies. We do a lot of, we call it defending your childhood, but it's the movies we grew up watching. So, you know, they're not always like the we hate movies, they're going to be bad movies, although a lot of them are. But they're movies that we think are pretty fun, and they should strike a nostalgic chord for most of you. Well, except for the ones Matt Quinn chose. He apparently lived on another planet for the rest of us when he was a kid. But, you know, most of these are childhood movies. Anyway, this is my favorite one of the three when I was a kid. I don't know why. I think it was when they showed up at Petra. I think that was cool. Like the, because in that first one, we have Indiana Jones running from the boulder, and we have that incredible intro scene to an incredible character. But in this one, he explains how he figures out these things. Like, he doesn't just know. He has to stumble through an obstacle course and figure it out as he goes, which I think is exciting. But anyway, stay tuned. Because next week is the one that everyone thought would be an episode. So, I guess, thanks. And again, thanks for those who came to see me at Cineprov. At the end of this month, I guess beginning of next month, they're doing a Halloween movie, or sorry, a Christmassy movie, but I won't be on it. I'll be joining you in the audience. However, at the end of the month, we are doing a kind of shorts, a Christmas shorts, and I will be riffing on one of those. So if you really want to see just me, I'll be there at the end of the month. But, you know, thanks for supporting us. Cineprov won People's Choice for Best Comedy Show this year, and it's all because of you guys. Without the people to vote, we would not have won it, and clearly the reviewers didn't think we deserved it. So, thanks, guys.
Hey, gang, are you looking for another podcast to listen to? Well, you're in luck. The Nerdy Laser is a podcast, and we specialize in 90s nerd culture. But we don't leave anything out. If something is cool and nerdy, we will talk about it. So join myself, Richard Yule, and a variety of guests on the Nerdy Laser Podcast, available on iTunes, Podbean, and the ESO Network.
Welcome to Life in Adventure Childhood this week. We did Last Crusade, the last of the... Oh no.
I see what you did there.
I was hoping it was.
But it was not the Indiana Jones movies.
Well, there was a TV show after it that got re-edited into TV movies. Is that what you're talking about?
I hope so. I'm Nick Hoffman, host of Wife Hope, and your father, and the funniest man in America.
Matthew W. Quinn.
Hello, this is Daniel, and I chose poorly.
I'm a speculative fiction writer.
Well, technically you are. I remember reading over that manuscript about 2006, and I thought it was pretty good.
It's 12 years old, guys. 12 years after I gave up my dream of being funny.
2006 was 12 years ago?
It sure was.
Oh, God.
I hadn't even graduated from college yet.
That was the year I graduated high school.
Are you that much younger than me?
Class of 06.
Oh, God. One of us aged better than the other. I think it was you.
Girl.
I will just start. This was my favorite when I was a kid.
Oh, mine too.
Yeah, I had the, I was going to say my mom was not a Star Wars fan, but it's not that she wasn't. It's just that she was an Indiana Jones fan. And for movies, in some ways, they're kind of similar. They're epic journeys. They're big movies. And so I ended up with all of them. But the Indiana Jones movies were the ones that I watched the most.
Hey, Steven, I got an idea to make a sequel to my space opera. It's going to be about just one guy.
It's going to be a better movie than the third one.
So I watched this one a lot.
Me too.
I remember seeing bits of, I think, at my grandmother's house. Like, I remember the glove slipping scene from the end and the tank tread scene, and there's another thing I remember. So that's two Indiana Jones movies I saw at my grandma's house, that and Raiders.
Yeah, those were the only two Indiana Jones movies that anybody cared about at the time.
Yeah, I mean,
Temple of Doom for a while was hated.
Well, and I mean, and it was one of these ones that was, I would say, summer release. But, you know, it was big when it came out, but it just didn't get the replay. The first one and the third one got all the replay value.
Mm-hmm.
And then that fourth one came out, which we'll get to, and people pretend it doesn't exist, but it exists. It's just...
Spoilers for that one. I kind of almost want to defend that, not because I think it's like some unsung masterpiece, but I think people just are way overreacting to it.
I agree.
Too much whiny entitled fan rage.
Basically, yes.
Well, and I think it's old people going back to a theater, and something that I think the movie does fall down on. This is practical effects. That one has so much CGI.
This is a great summary of the fandom mentality that I heard from Joel Hodgson once. We can make you laugh, but we can't make you 13 again.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And as someone who does the Joel Hodgson thing and does Mystery Science Theater-ish
riffing,
that's kind of what you have to grab onto. The fact you make fun of expectations.
Did you see that the BBC released what a couple of the episodes in the new season are going to be?
For Mystery Science Theater?
Yeah.
I heard that.
Yeah, Mac and me.
I saw, and they're not wrong.
The McDonald's tie-in movie?
Yes.
Yeah. And despite what you think, McDonald's apparently was not a buyer into it. They just...
Were that desperate?
They were.
Oh, God.
It tells you what the 80s were like for them. Matt, can you give us a plot synopsis?
Well, I will do it in character as Henry Jones Sr. Mm-hmm. This one features... You're going back to his roots, fighting the Nazis.
Hey, Daniel, how long do you think
this
before
case,
he gets up?
He has to fight them for the Holy Grail, because otherwise, with the Nazis get it, the armies of darkness will sweep over the world.
Dr. Jones, it sounds like you had a stroke.
At this point, I might well have. I am, after all, 90 years old.
Uh-huh.
Yep.
Genius of the Restoration.
Oh, God, what's the fuck? Next line, something of the something. Marcus Brody, they're trying to outdrunk each other in that scene, I think. What Dr. Jones said there is nailing it.
There's a lot of nailing going on in this one.
Kind of. After some, I guess, like you said, criticism from the last one about it being... Well, a different formula. This one goes back to the formula in that he's fighting for treasure at the beginning and then ends up back at the university and then has a scene with Marcus Brody where they talk about, well, what could be going on.
It hits a lot of the same beats that Raiders did. There's that epic opening scene where he's chasing a random artifact. In this case, it's the Cross of Coronado. And you get this great, great prequel of Indiana Jones as a 12-year-old, I think.
Mm-hmm. He's a life scout. He's probably a little older.
Possibly, I don't really know, but either way, it's kid Indiana Jones still doing Indiana Jones stuff.
It's his origin story.
Yeah, basically.
I mean, and we get the origin of the scar on his chin. We get the origin of where he gets the fedora.
Why he hates snakes.
Yes.
And it's just, it's the cute version of why I hate so much of those, of X-Men Origins Wolverine, like... Mm-hmm. Because there, we're like, we don't need to know why you like motorcycles. We don't need to know where you get that leather jacket.
Well, this time it felt kind of organic, though. I mean, it was...
That's what I'm saying. I like this.
Yeah,
This does it very well. And, you know, not to take the wind out of your sails like Matt did a second ago. This is great.
Yeah.
I think this is good. And I like the circus train going through. It feels very... I mean, I hate to keep saying this, but it feels very much like a Bond scene.
Mm-hmm.
But... It flows. Like, I don't know how he did it, maybe on the bottom of a helicopter, but he's panning through from an impossible change of landscape, but it's all in the same state at least. We go through like Monument Valley to a wooded area to like a train, and then we end up in this small city outside of Salt Lake City in Utah.
Yeah.
And It does have one of my favorite lines from the nameless Indiana Jones, not Indiana Jones guy, who goes...
Fedora.
Yeah, from Fedora.
Yeah.
Who's a kid you lost today, but you don't have to like it, and then he gives him his hat.
Well, I actually like those villains in this one because they're chasing him. There's that one bit where he ends up in the train car with a lion, and they actually save Indiana Jones's life. I mean, partly to get the artifact that he took back, but also because, you know... They might be crooks, but they're not monsters.
Well, I like it all. I like the idea that he's like, kid, you lost, but you did good today.
Yeah.
Like, everything about it, like even Indiana Jones' righteous indignation about it belonging in a museum, like it's on character. It's something that, frankly, these prequel off movies should take a note from. You don't need to change the character. We know who they're going to be. Figure it out. And also, it's, what, half an hour of this? Of a two-hour movie? Not even? 20 minutes?
It was like 20 minutes
or
so.
It went on for a while.
I disagree. It flew by.
I'm with Daniel. Like, that's the problem with Solo. I think Solo is not a bad idea, but show me him as an adult. Give me 20 minutes of this, and then give me another adventure that is affected by this. Here, we get a... We color Indiana Jones... And then we have a normal-length Indiana Jones movie.
Yeah.
That, I think, really works. And it sets up a contentious relationship with a father figure that he doesn't know.
Now, I was of mixed feelings, because in this opening bit, they introduce the father, which is, as Matt explained earlier, it's Sean Connery.
Yes, he's busy reading a manuscript and demanding his son speak to him in Greek.
Yes.
Which we get back to. It's the diary that we find that is the entire plot driver for the entire rest of the movie.
Well, the joke in this case is, okay, Indiana Jones is literally the son of James Bond, right?
Right.
But I wasn't sure, and maybe you guys would know, would it have been more effective if the father didn't show up in that opening sequence and you only saw Sean Connery much later in the movie? Or is it fine the way it is?
I think it's fine the way it is, because it shows and doesn't tell he didn't have a great relationship with his dad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, please.
Because you get him later saying he's an art teacher no one wants, but before you see him just blowing his son off.
Yeah.
When there's a major crisis happening.
Well, and they even explain it later on saying, I wanted you to be self-reliant. Like, when literally in the room behind him, the sheriff shows up, a dozen assholes show up with guns, and he doesn't even enter the frame. He's unimaginably the worst father we've seen in any of these movies.
Yeah.
He really is.
Well, I mean, that's Spielberg's thing, is show a bad or absent father.
And I also like that it's also clearly Sean Connery playing the character. Mm-hmm. They don't find another actor, and so they just don't show his face because they're not going to...
Yeah.
A joke that they make in a worse movie, but they're not going to euthanize him. But, like, you know, they're not going to CGI his face. This is an Ant-Man with Michael Douglas.
Yeah.
Right? Which is something you can do now and be okay.
Well, I don't know. That Tron movie where they de-aged Jeff Bridges. Oh, boy.
We'll get to Tron.
The Captain Marvel has the de-aged Samuel L. Jackson. It looks pretty good from the trailer.
I have not watched the trailer because I'm not sure if I'm going to watch the movie. We'll see.
Doesn't she crash through a blockbuster?
Yeah. Oh, very 90s.
Yeah. That's... As we all lived through it, we don't necessarily need to revisit every single aspect of it. Certainly not Blockbuster.
I mean, and I'm sure they also crashed through a picture of Bill Clinton getting blowjob and a Big Mac. And it would have been a McRib.
Yes.
He would have been eating a McRib. Speaking of, we still need to do the Flintstones, don't we?
At some point.
Oh, my God. Speaking
of... Oh, and if there's...
He would, wouldn't he? He'd be sitting in the chair in the Oval Office eating a McRib.
Oh, that's good, darling, yeah.
Was that your Bill Clinton just now? Was that your Bill Clinton just now? I'm not dropping this. Was that your Bill Clinton just now?
Trying to.
Well, son, that was a very bad impersonation of me.
Girl, have you seen that new McRib sandwich?
Hey, girl. I got some meat you can munch on.
Back up. None of us are very good.
No, that's...
Listen to Slow Burn Season 2. We're way off topic because this movie is flawless and I don't think it is.
Oh, man, yeah.
So, anyway, after we have that cutscene, they're back on the ship on a... We got to
flash forward to him as an adult, and he's back on a ship in the middle of a storm trying to steal the same cross that he almost got as a kid from the same guy.
Yeah, and we're off of Portugal, and he grabs the cross as a wave hits it. Then there's an explosion on the ship. Mm-hmm. He makes it back, and we get... Again, this is what I like. This is a Bond kind of cliche, but he goes back to the university. Marcus Brody is there. They're talking about it. They deal with the old mission.
Was that also the case in this one where after he leaves... Well, first he gives a great little lecture about archaeology at an introductory lecture with the whole...
difference between truth and
fact. If it's truth you want, then Dr. So-and-so is right down the hall teaching philosophy.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it turns out he's very behind on grading papers. You know, reality ensued.
Yeah, that's the one bit, because he's like surrounded by students who've been waiting for him to have office hours.
Yeah, I mean, I love that the women are still just staring him down, which is a good joke. They used to call me Indiana Jones at my first job because the girls followed me around the hallway.
Those must have been good days.
Yeah, it was weird days, that's for sure.
And he's, for all this talk about everything belonging in a museum, his office is full of artifacts.
Well, also, this is the part where I sympathized him working at a university because he's in a shitty office with the boiler. Did you notice that? Behind him is like a furnace.
Well, because he's barely in his office.
So. Oh, right, but it's just like... He might be the most important person to the university, but he's a young guy without any, like, actual, like, tenure. So they just stick him in some coat closet with a furnace in it.
Welcome to academia.
Yeah, and he has to escape to the window. It's great.
Where he gets picked up by three G-Men. Gestapo guys.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they look like G-Men. They're wearing gray suits and hats. Like,
yeah.
And then we end up being introduced to Donovan.
Yes, who was in Empire Strikes Back, that actor, I think?
He was in Empire Strikes Back. He's a Pinewood guy, and he's amazing. He's also in For Your Eyes Only. He plays the Greek guy.
Oh, that was him.
You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. Okay.
He's the one who's trying to rat out the Greek guy, but he turns out to actually be the villain in the For Your Eyes Only. So
this movie has, let's keep count here, it's got a James Bond and a Bond villain.
And a guy who wanted to direct all the Bond movies. And since it's Pinewood, there's a lot of extras who are also in Bond movies.
Wasn't Alison Dooley a Bond girl?
She was.
Okay.
So again, it just keeps piling up. And at a dinner party, they have a rubbing, an etch of a...
Well, they have a marker that they found during an expedition in North Africa that Donovan asked Jones to take a look at, and Indiana Jones realized it describes the location of the Holy Grail.
Effectively. And then he has a illuminated manuscript, which happens to be where we start the movie,
mm-hmm.
which is... something his father was transcribing at the very beginning.
Yes, because that was all his dad cared about.
Right. And we get into this realm of what archaeology means to these men. For Indiana Jones, it's this idea of freedom. It's protecting knowledge for everyone to enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
For the Nazis, it's controlling that information. And for his father, from a filmic perspective, his father's the one with an arc,
mm-hmm.
right? Because his father was the one who was obsessed about this forever, and his father's the only one who realizes that knowledge is something that should be attained but let go of. Right.
Or at the very least, there's more important things than just old objects.
Yeah, like don't die for it.
Well, and his son will effectively destroy all of his work, the entire movie, which is something that we don't really acknowledge, but we'll get to as we get to.
Oh, that's another thing. One of the greatest moments that really explains his character, the Henry Jones Sr.'s character, which, by the way, Indiana Jones' real name is Henry Jones Jr., anyway, is when...
Indiana? Indiana, what's the dog's name?
Your name is after the dog!
This is right before Jonathan Rhys-Davies does about 5 minutes about how much he hates the Muslims, Indy! The Muslims! Because he's a famous right-wing racist now.
I thought, isn't Salah supposed to be Muslim?
He may be, but he's, in real life, Jonathan Rhys-Davies has had some very famous, like, he was on Hannity a few times, and he's kind of a racy guy.
Gimli, stay away from the mead.
Yeah, exactly right.
Anyway, the thing that I think explains his character the most is when they break into that castle where Sean Connery's being held captive, and then he busts his head with that vase, and he's
that's so good.
Ming Dynasty, 11th century. I'll 14th. Never forgive.
Please.
Oh, 14th, excuse me.
As an AP World guy, it's 14th.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah.
But he's like,
what
going,
your ass that is.
I'll never forgive myself. And then it's like, oh, well, it was just a little bling. 14th century. He cares more about the vase than the fact that he just hit his son over the head
and
with that.
And hasn't seen him in 20 years, yeah. Apparently. And he goes, oh, thank goodness.
Oh, thank... It's a fake. You can tell by the cross-stitching.
Oh, my God. And he goes, I'm fine too, Dad. He goes, I'm glad to hear it. I mean, and it's funny because here's the thing about it. I mean, my dad doesn't listen and we get along fine. But there is this kind of understanding where there's this distance, but then they get along on the things that they understand for each other. Mm-hmm. So he is impressed with his son's archaeology, right? And
I think he's just more shocked that there's several scenes where his son's a cold-blooded killer.
He's surprised, yeah. There, but when they find Sir Richard, he's genuinely impressed with his son.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. This is kind of funny. Throughout most of the movie, Henry Jones is not an action hero. He's James Bond playing a non-action guy.
Yeah.
Well, because he's an old man at that point. That's the whole thing. He's
I'm going to give this
and
to
an
Matt.
Academic.
Well, yeah. But I mean, he's also just an old man in a tweed jacket and like a sailor's cap. Like it's like a pull down old, like it's like a Stetson that like is floppy. It's great. He's wearing a Gilligan cap with a tweed blazer and has an umbrella strapped to a leather suitcase or a leather briefcase rather. It's perfect. It's really perfect. This is a passing of the torch. This is what James Bond Jr. should have been, for Christ's sake. It's Batman Beyond.
Yeah, basically.
Like the curmudgeonly old Bruce Wayne who doesn't give two shits about the guy.
Oh, I love Batman Beyond.
What's the Return of the Joker movie?
Oh, that was great.
That's a stay tuned.
Oh my god.
The rated or unrated version?
Unrated.
Oh my god, that hardcore sex scene between him and Harley Quinn.
Mm-hmm.
This is why you get an unrated rating, man.
Well, we're talking, of course, about the sex scene between Terry McGinnis and the elderly Harley Quinn.
Good geriatric hardcore.
Mm-hmm.
Harold and Maude.
I need to dust off my best Jason Mantzoukas, but she's a mature.
So, well, before he meets his father, though, there's that whole bit where Donovan's essentially hiring Indiana to find the Grail, and when they're talking about, well, we hired a specialist, but his team's gone missing, and then when Indy says, you gotta hire my dad instead of me, there's like, well, your dad's the one who's missing.
This is GD Lost World. Jurassic Park, remember, like, Goldblum goes to Hammond and goes, I'm not going to do your mission.
Mm-hmm.
Hire someone else. And he goes, we did hire someone else. And they're missing.
Yeah.
Right? Like, this is literally it. And it's like, it just happens to be your girlfriend instead of your father.
Right? Yeah.
I mean, that's a, I mean,
Spielberg, he likes callbacks.
I was going to say, I love El Spielbergo, his
non-Mexican equivalent.
But the problem is, of course, sometimes you can't reference yourself. He goes, well, you know, well, it did work in Indiana Jones. We should do it for Jurassic Park, the sequel. No, you really shouldn't. You don't need a sequel to a masterpiece. And he goes, well, Jaws 2 turned out to be really shit. But, you know, I could make a sequel.
Well,
hey, Mark, I can make a sequel.
Isn't this like one of the few sequels that Spielberg's ever done? I mean, it was this and The Lost World and...
Temple.
Yeah, and Temple. Well, it's the Indiana Jones movies and then The Lost World and...
That's it.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it. I think those are the only sequels he's ever done.
Yeah. I mean, he'll get paid for them, but he won't direct them.
Yeah.
Because he's smarter than that. I mean, I think Schindler's List 2 was kind of tasteless. I mean, a musical?
But I don't know. The geriatric sex scene was kind of unnecessary.
I mean, but if you're going to get an R, you might as well go for the R rating.
And for a penny and for a pound.
Yeah.
Oh, God, we're going to hell, aren't we?
Well, I mean, the fact that Bad Quinn referenced the fact that sometimes you only need to pay a penny to get pounded is a little rough.
Mm.
Speaking of
going to hell, what was interesting about this was...
Segway.
Yes, Segway. Whereas the first one, they were referencing the biblical story of the Ark of the Covenant all the time. This time, they're more leaning on Arthurian legend and this made-up thing about knights during the... First Crusade or Second Crusade?
First Crusade. Siege of Alexandretta.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the fact that the First Crusade, that's kind of the thing. Like, they robbed the Holy Land of their treasures and mm-hmm. they went back. I think I like the return to the Judeo-Christian myth, not because, as a Catholic myself, I know the stories, but because it allows for a magic that we that he uses and doesn't feel like he's taking advantage of. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. I have nothing opposed to theoretically discovering ancient treasures, but it really does reek of the British saying, "Now those are ours, isn't it?" Right? And so here it's really, because the Nazis really were claiming ancient treasures to really use for this, and they stole the Spear of Destiny and Crowns of Thorns and Vials of Christ's Blood, and like that's what the Nazis did. So the argument that he's saying, like, we're fighting evil, rings more true than Temple of Doom. But at least in Temple of Doom, he's really going into it to save kids.
Yeah.
Here, they end up in Berlin and get Hitler's signature.
Oh, that was a great moment.
I love
that. That was a great scene.
So I'm not gonna lie. I knew it was coming, so to me it tickled me. But I don't know what it would have looked like in 1989. But this is great. Right? It is. It's truly wonderful. Daniel, advance us on the plot, Daniel.
Oh, well, we've been jumping around a little bit, but the next bits that we talk about is Marcus and Indiana going over to Venice, which is, well, first they go to his dad's house, and Indiana remembers that he got a package from Venice, Italy, and it turns out to be his dad's diary about all the Grail lore that he'd collected from sources over the years.
Yeah.
So they go to Venice to try and retrace his dad's steps, and they find the second marker that explains where the Grail is underneath that underneath that church that had been converted into a library.
Well, and this is very Bondy in that they do a good job of going to a cool old city and finding a thing which is real, which is that old church which has been converted to a library, which is a real place, which I've been to.
Mm-hmm.
And Thomas, who just didn't do the homework for this week, so isn't on this episode, has also been there. And it's a beautiful church in an old town square, and you can go in and you can see it. And there is something neat about going to these real old places,
mm-hmm.
right? Like Saint-Chapelle in Paris or into Bruges, and where you see
just Rome in general.
Like, yeah, and like old Catholicism or Christianity has this weight to it that feels like we should understand it, which is why, despite the general crappiness and pulpiness of those books, Dan Brown works. Because there is a lost language there that feels impressive, that Spielberg as a director nails.
Have you ever been to the Sistine Chapel?
Of course.
Oh, yeah.
A couple times. And you get that, right?
Yeah.
As a small person, you look up at these 30-foot-high ceilings and see a masterpiece that envelops you mm-hmm. in a dark room, and you're just like, there are greater powers than me. Right?
And well, it was all, and the fact that it was all just one man doing that for 3 years.
On his back, painting on plaster that the second it dried, it dies. You realize that he believed in something more powerful than, and in doing so, he touches something close that we will never get, which is why this movie works. In seeing the cup of Christ, there's power.
Yes. Right?
Like, and other directors do things like this and they fail because they don't do it. And the one I'm thinking of is, we did the first National Treasure movie. You and I disagreed on it, but I like the action of it more than you did. But that's what they're reaching for. That magic that comes from a misunderstood but powerful organization like the Masons, tying it to our founding.
Yeah.
This is doing the same thing with Christianity and saying there's a magic associated with the Holy Grail, which goes beyond understanding and into faith, that Spielberg succeeds at and John Turteltaub fails at, which I know is baffling. I know that you thinking about how great John Turteltaub is would shock you that he doesn't nail. But
when did we turn into like an NPR podcast on religious icons?
I've taught this before.
Today is our pledge drive. If you donate such and such amount of money, we'll give you a tote bag.
I mean a toten bag.
I've got all sorts of shit I need toten.
Oh, my God. I did this. I teach at a large but generic Catholic school, and we have Protestants who teach there. About 40% of our staff is Protestant. We went to a church, and I was pointing out...
Please, please, please. In that context, they're heathens.
Please.
Heretics.
Oh. is there not a barbershop called Heretics? And they do crazy hairstyles and crazy dye jobs.
That's like the store that's next to Bob's Burgers in the open credits, Heretics.
How is it not? Oh, my God.
Because
goodness.
Life's not fair, children.
Well, anyway, speaking of that, the next bit is they actually go down and find the tomb, which is like, and this is kind of weird for an archaeologist, but I guess it's more of an adventure. He is just so callous about all the bodies that are down there.
Yeah, I mean, so it's the whole, it's a catacomb. Like, they're underneath Venice. Yeah. Venice is flooding. He smells gas. They're looking for the tomb of St. Richard. They mm-hmm. find it. He does a rubbing to complete the missing rubbing.
What I'm talking about specifically is where he finds the petroleum and it's dark, so he just takes someone's femur and turns it into a torch.
This is going back to him being a weird archaeology guy.
Yeah, well, archaeology and paleontology from the late 19th, early 20th century is a lot less careful. Like, the two great paleontologists waged a bone war. They probably destroyed more fossils than they salvaged.
One correction to
by
you.
By blowing stuff up.
Because that was 75 years before this.
Yeah.
1880-ish to 1930-ish.
It was 1880s.
It was like
1840s to 60.
Mm-hmm. The bone wars? Bone wars, pretty sure, after the Civil War.
Possibly, but the field was really getting started in the 1840s.
Even if I give you the Civil War, that's 1860, and this is 1938. So we're talking about 68 years later. Now, that being said, he's made fun of for destroying things in 1932, which is mm-hmm. 6 years before this.
Oh, was that when Temple of Doom took place?
Yeah, 1932.
I'll take your word for it.
But, I mean, also, the guy he discovers, the crusader that he's really looking for, second he does a rubbing, he dumps the corpse to the side to hide underneath the sarcophagus.
Yeah, because the Illuminati, or whoever those guys are trying to set the catacombs on fire.
The
Knights of the...
The Knights of the Cruciform Sword.
Yes.
Which are a real group.
Oh.
Yes. Which are the people who protect the Cup of Christ. Who the Knights of Malta, who are also real, and apparently this is also true, the head of the Federalist Society, the guy who chose Kavanaugh, is a member of the Knights of Malta, apparently tried to eradicate them in the 1950s.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, these are nutjob Catholics who still exist. Mel Gibson is one of the Knights of Malta, so...
Where does, William Donahue, where does he fit in that?
The pedophile camp.
Okay.
Expose the networks, man. The Catholic Church and the Illuminati and the Supreme Court.
No, William...
Well, lastly, Republicans appointed the Supreme Court have all been Catholic. We're taking over.
William Donahue's the guy who, like, you can't have a scene with the Virgin Mary in that movie. That's offensive to me. And it's like, dude, the Vatican doesn't care what you think. Nobody cares what you think.
Donahue's kind of a schmuck. Using a Semitic word to...
Oigewalt.
It's okay.
How do you say Oigewalt in Latin?
Avi.
Avi.
That's just hey.
Speaking of Indiana Jones in this scene, how can you keep your eyes open under petroleum?
Oh, I think the idea is maybe it's just water. It's got oil mixed in it rather than...
I'm pretty sure he says, no, this is petroleum.
Yeah. Also, that scene is very Bond. It's also very Pierce Brosnan Bond, right? Because they do a lot of underwater with him because he looks glorious underwater.
Mm-hmm.
So glorious. Anyway, they make it out. Then there's a boat chase, which is... Also very Bond.
Yes, where a lot of those knights end up dying except for the one.
The one who tells them what they are. He goes, look, I'm only in it for my father.
Mm-hmm.
And they let him go, but then the Nazis show back up. Well, he says his father is in a castle in Austria.
On the border of Austria-Hungary.
Austria and Germany.
Germany,
hasn't happened yet.
Right.
This is 38, early 38.
The Anschluss was in March, so this would have had to be in January or February.
Well, that makes sense because gets to the castle, he's got a sniffle.
Yeah. Although, I will say that is an error because we'll get there.
Yeah, well.
We'll get there.
The contradiction between the Anschluss and the Republic of Hatay and how they didn't overlap.
You're so bad at the storytelling, but yes, that is absolutely correct. So they get to this castle, and Indy Jones shows up pretending to be a Scottish
lord
who's looking at tapestries.
Yes, this is a castle. Do you not have tapestries?
I thought that was pretty funny. Yeah, oh, that was great.
I agree with you. It's funny. He's doing a Monty Python bit, and it's funny to me because the guy playing his father, Sean Connery, is actually Scottish.
Scrooge McDuck would have watched that scene. It's like, whoa, dude, scale it back.
Yeah, 20% less on this.
Yeah.
But it's funny because the guy immediately calls him out and goes, if you're Scottish, then I'm Mickey Mouse.
Well, if you look closely at his lips, he's actually saying Jesse Owens. It's kind of distracting.
You know, a better person edited that out, which I will say was probably not Stephen, but it was someone close to Stephen. That's a Kathy Kennedy poll, I think.
Well, I'm pretty sure the reason was, well, nobody's going to know who Jesse Owens is. It's like, I know who Jesse Owens is.
I'm going to say someone made the right call. It's a better line.
Okay.
It's a fine line.
Okay.
Are you going to argue?
No.
You want to go?
I'm not going to argue.
Six of one, half dozen of the other. You know, you could have historical accuracy or something that's timeless.
Yeah. I mean, both are fine. I mean,
that's what I just thought at the time. I just thought that the editing on it was distracting because it looked like a dubbed Bruce Lee bit.
They could have done a better job.
Yeah.
Now, that being said, we move past it. Indy punches him out. Him and Elsa figure out the room that the dad is in. They go to the room over. He swings around using some really quick bullwhip tricks.
Yeah.
We get the bullwhip again here, which is nice.
And then we get the scene that I think we've already described with Sean Connery hitting Harrison Ford with a fake vase.
A fake vase, and he goes, it's okay, it's fake.
Yeah.
But we have this thing where he keeps calling him a junior, he gets pissed off, and Indy then shoots 12 guys with a rifle.
Yeah. Look what you did!
He goes, look what you did.
Look what you did!
Yeah. I'll work on my accent, we'll get there.
And then after that is when we realize that Elsa was working for the Nazis, which I think we should have been able to tell based on her name and her accent.
And she sleeps with everyone, which is a good
She show. Talks in her sleep.
Yeah. How do you know she was a Nazi? She talks in her sleep. Which is a good joke.
That is a good joke.
It takes Indy a second, too. It takes us all a second. And Sir Sean kind of nails it.
Yeah, and
nails it in multiple senses of the word.
Well, the whole point was that the Nazis were looking for the diary that Indiana now has, and that's why his dad mailed it to him, was to get it away from Europe, and so he, of course, brought it back, and so it falls into the Nazis' hands, and Donovan's there.
Dun-dun-dun.
I told you not to trust anybody, which is, of course, a line that
should have been in it has been in so many Bond movies.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know. Like, I like Donovan in this. He, like we mentioned before, he's in For Your Eyes Only. He's in Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back. He's also in that terrible movie, Troy, which we might get to.
Oh!
I saw. In 2004.
We did see.
Oh, that.
I mean, that doesn't make it any better. I'm glad I saw a movie with you, but it's a train wreck. It is.
The one movie where Sean Bean doesn't die.
Yeah. I remember the model that played Helen of Troy was quite an attractive woman, which
she was in National Treasure as well. What's her name? Kruger.
That was the same person.
Yeah.
That was her?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Eric Banner's in it too. Brendan Gleeson is in it. Brendan Gleeson plays Menelaus.
So now we find Indiana and Henry in a pickle because they are tied in the middle of a castle with, first the Nazis were specifically looking for a map that was in the diary, but Indiana tore that out and gave it to Marcus.
Oh, which is a great line, which is like, Marcus Brody speaks a dozen languages and
has connections all over the world. He'll blend in.
And then he goes, is that true about Marcus? He goes, no, he got lost once in his own music.
Oh, I love the cutaway where it shows him in the marketplace, and he's going, does anybody here speak English or maybe ancient Greek?
And we meet Sala again, because wasn't Sala in Raiders of the Lost Ark?
Yeah, but he was not in Temple. And Jonathan Rhys-Davies here is really just, he is so good in this. He goes, Mr. Marcus!
Marcus Brody, sir!
Oh, he was great.
He's good, and he has this big over-the-top, like, I mean, and I don't know how else to say it, but bigness to him. Like, he bear hugs. Like, he's a huge dude here.
Oh, well, there's also that great scene where the Nazi agent's asking for his identification papers. Like, yes, Egyptian male, morning edition. Just finished reading it to myself. That was amazing.
Yeah, he's funny. His lines are quick. He's good in this movie. It's why Gimli is such a weird turn.
That was perfect casting. When I heard that he was going to be Gimli the first time, I was like, that's awesome.
Nobody touches a dwarf.
Yeah, that was awesome.
But regardless, so you then cut quickly to the fact that the Nazis and are looking, which we now know Donovan is attached to, are all looking for the same thing. They're trying to get this map. It turns out that Jonathan Rhys-Davies, despite his best efforts, cannot protect Brody, who is
the most
incompetent character.
Yeah, he hustles him into like hiding place. It turns out it's actually the back of a Nazi truck.
Yeah.
Oops.
We have the Africa Corps like thing, and I mean, this is Spielberg being good again. Like, the set dressing on all of this is so good. I was thinking, like, if I had to pick something to do, obviously I'm not a good actor, but to design the diary. Because they flip through it a lot. Like, it's not like in Raiders or something where they immediately turn to the right page, so you know the rest is blank.
Mm-hmm.
There's just crap in there. Like, there's just stuff, and it's all sketches, and it's all cool imagery and iconography, and it's such a neat piece.
Oh, yeah, that... You're not wrong. You're not wrong. I mean, that was definitely had the feeling of something that had been worked on for decades.
Well, and every inch of this movie is... It's something Spielberg... It's something, of course, CGI ruins for everyone, but everything, top to bottom, is filled with beauty. Like, it looks so good. Everything. And the characters are defined. Like, I mean, it's a Matt Groening line. But in silhouette, you should be able to tell who these characters are. Mm-hmm. And they do that a few times. Indiana Jones is often in silhouette, and we know who he is because of the lapels on his jacket and his hat.
Yeah.
And you could do the same thing with Sean Connery's character, with Henry Jones Sr. And it's that hat, those glasses, that way he is.
Kind of do it with Elsa, too, really.
You could do it with Donovan, like... I love the way these movies come together.
Yes.
It makes it work in a way that, God, so many of the movies we have, just don't.
Because it knows how to have fun. And I'll skip ahead a couple minutes, but while they're in the castle, Indiana has a cigarette lighter and, like, asks Henry to burn through the ropes that they're tied to, right?
And he holds it at the wrong angle and burns his fingers and burns the castle down.
All those tapestries must have been soaked in gas or something.
That must be the varnish on the table.
I don't know what it was, but that fire spread quick.
And meanwhile, you have somehow there's a least company strength German military force in Austria, which at the time was still an independent country.
Well, that doesn't really mean a whole lot.
Going on.
So keep rotating in and out of the secret Nazi lair and the secret passage.
Well, that was a great bit where they find the secret passage and they're just sitting there while the Nazi officers are there and that woman sees them and they're just like giggling and smiling at her.
Well, and as it turns around and you have this kind of closed door farce thing, you keep going back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
And to make a correction to Matt, the Anschluss had already happened by the time this movie happened.
They still have a border post, though. The one they keep going back and forth through in the motorcycle still has the Austrian flag on it.
Well, right, but it says June 1938 in this movie.
I didn't see the specific month.
Yeah, and that's why the Republic of Hatay exists, because it's created in June. In July. So it's summer. But whatever.
Maybe they just forgot to take the border post down.
Well, either way, a lot of Nazis get killed.
Well, they get burned down in this movie.
They get burned down. They get poles shoved through the bikes that they're riding on, so the bikes explode.
The motorcycle sequence.
Yeah.
They go down the river. He tricks them to go down the river, and then he steals the motorcycle.
Yeah.
And then the planes start to appear.
We're not taking the boat?
Yeah. They end up getting a dirigible... Mm-hmm. out of Germany to go to
Who knows? Looks like out of Germany. Looks like Italy.
Well, they just said it's the first available flight out of Germany.
Yeah, and they end up over these mountains.
Well, before that, that's when the sequence happens where they go to recover the diary in Berlin, right. And it's the middle of a Nazi book burning.
And he has this great line to Elsa, which is the whole, like, I don't believe... She goes, I don't believe in these people. And he goes, look, I wasn't the one who stood to be counted.
Yeah.
And...
Well, there's also that bit where he's like, you represent everything that the Grail stands against. Who gives a damn what you think?
Yeah. And, I mean, and he goes... She goes, why would you come back to Berlin for this diary? You have all the information you need. And he goes, I'm not here for you to burn another book.
Hmm.
And, you know, again, it's this standing up against fascism stuff. It's very well done.
Well, it leads to the best line in this movie about a little later with Sean Connery going, it tells me that goose-stepping morons like yourself should try reading books instead of burning them.
Yeah. I mean, like, again, it's this anti-fascist thing, but it's also just knowledge.
Yeah.
Like, it's the importance of knowledge. Now, it ends with possibly the best, one of the best laugh lines of these movies, which is that he runs into Hitler, and Hitler
with the whole autograph
thing.
Well, there were a lot of people around that had like notebooks out and stuff. I mean, that was something he did.
I mean, again, he's a celebrity at that point, but it's just, it's a funny scene.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good scene. At which point they then take a dirigible, which ends up in a plane fighting sequence. Which is fantastic, because mm-hmm. Connery... I love the idea that Connery is an incompetent fighter.
What happens at 11 o'clock?
Yeah, which is a dumb joke. But
it's a terrible joke, but Sean Connery sells it so well.
He pulls out his timepiece. What happens at 11? and then they explain the joke, which is 12, 11, 10, 9, 11 o'clock. He then shoots through their own tail. The plane crashes. And they make a run for it, but then
they steal that poor shepherd's car, don't they?
Which is good. And then they have my favorite line, which is your favorite line, which is they end up on a beach.
Mm-hmm.
There's a bunch of seagulls there, and a German bomber, a Messerschmitt, is coming around to shoot them or whatever, drop another bomb. We don't know. And then Indy takes out his handgun, checks. There's a few guns left. And then his father takes the umbrella, pushes Indy away, gives him the suitcase. And then starts to flash the umbrella at a bunch of seagulls who fly up, knock down the plane. Do you have the line? You want me to do it?
You do it.
I suddenly remembered my Charlemagne. Make my soldiers the rocks of the ground and the birds in the sky. And then he throws the umbrella over his shoulder and walks away like he's in...
Like he's a badass.
I mean, like he's in, I don't know, Mary Poppins or something. And there's this look from Harrison Ford, which ends the scene, which is he respects his father. Like, they're not people who get along, but they respect each other,
mm-hmm.
which is extraordinarily well done in a movie where it's two men who don't express emotion, and they're expressing emotion here, which is phenomenal. It's excellent.
Yeah.
And
this was after the scene on the dirigible where it's kind of a talky-talk scene, but it's the scene about... Indy's fractured relationship with his dad, where dad's like, did I ever tell you to wash up or go to bed or do your homework? No, I taught you self-reliance.
He says, I needed a father, and you weren't a father to me.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, what do you have to tell me then? What do you want to talk about? And he goes, I have nothing to say. And he goes, well, then let's work.
Well, yeah. Well, then what are you complaining about?
Work. It's one thing that either of them understand,
mm-hmm.
which is excellent relationship stuff. Like, it's... I think Spielberg loves broken homes. He's practically Disney.
Yeah.
But that's something where he gets it. I think it's an excellent scene, frankly.
Yeah.
And then from here, we end up tracking down the Grail Man.
Basically, yeah. They end up...
Petra.
Yeah, they end up there, and Donovan's also there trying to bribe a sultan with a Rolls Royce, and it works.
Yeah, in the Republic of Hatay, which exists for exactly 9 months, which I think is neat, because...
Wouldn't it have been so much better if it was King Farouk?
I mean, that's getting back to Tintin, where, like, what if it was someone from the first movie? Right? Like, if it was just full circle, like, yeah. if it was... I mean, obviously Balak dies, no. But like if we ended up back in Egypt because this is all bullshit anyway, like why not?
What? Exactly.
Action Russia, of course. It's like you could have just said anything. You could have said Jordan. You could have said whatever you
could have said Alexandra.
Yeah, you could have said the ancient lost city of Alexandria. Whatever, do it. Anyway, but Petra is a real place. It's a place I want to go where they carve it into the rock and like they actually end up there. But
I just think it would have been so funny if it was they were dealing with King Farouk in the middle of this movie. Jeez.
Full circle, man. Full circle. So we end up there, and Indy actually has the diary to do the three tasks of the Holy Grail.
Right.
And what? After an incredible fight sequence involving a tank, which we're not going to recreate.
Oh, we can't. There's no way of doing
it. You have to see it. It's so good.
That's something I remember for probably nearly 30 years, because I don't remember ever seeing this movie in its entirety, but I remember the treads.
Yes.
Yeah, and it's good, and I love how they get the dad, and they have Marcus Brody, and Brody somehow drunks his way out of that movie. He falls off the back of the tank somehow, and
it works.
He's fine, and then everyone thinks Indy is dead, and they're all okay with it. It's
and Sala saves Henry after Henry's dragged on the treads, which was that looked brutal.
It does, and like Indy's being stabbed while he's trying to barely support his father, and it's just. It's amazing. It's rough around the edges. It's such a good scene. The Nazis die. They end up at Petra, which is just called the something something. I don't even know. But it's a real place in Turkey called Petra. And they have the three tasks of the Grail.
Yes. Well, they find the Canyon of the Crescent Moon, and the Nazis are already there, and they don't know what these three tests are, so they're just sending random people in there to try and get past the first one, and they all end up getting decapitated.
Right.
You have the medieval buzzsaws.
Well, it's specifically, it's the breath of God, the path of God.
The breath of God, the word of God, and then it's a leap of faith.
Right.
Which is the path of God, I think is the third one.
Yes.
And so the first one is great. All we know is the description, which is that the wind of God, or the breath of God, which is that a penitent man will pass.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Jones, the father, Sean Connery, has been shot in the gut.
By Donovan.
By Donovan, saying like, look, you're going to lead us to the treasure. And he goes, I'm not going to help you. Mm-hmm. And shooting me is not going to help me any faster. He goes, you're right. And he just turns the gun and shoots the father, which is A, very Bond, but B, it's brilliantly directed.
Well, yeah. Oh, big time.
I mean, and the other thing, which is that there are stupid, dumb parts of the script, but when you have a good cast and a good director, you don't care.
If you're emotionally involved, you can overlook anything.
And this movie has a pulse. It moves. Mm-hmm. And when Sean Connery demands you stop a scene for a second, for whatever reason, to tell you that his emotional relationship with his son is dead, but they still respect each other, you go along with it. And that's what people don't understand about, I think, Spielberg. He is popcorn movie, but he also really knows how movies are made.
And yeah.
This shows it, right? And for, I mean, a Jewish guy who you really don't get the feeling believes in magic, he believes in people.
Mm-hmm.
This is a movie about magic, and it's driven by the people, right? Like,
right.
Specifically Christian magic, and it's still driven by the people, and that's amazing, because it's an incredible film here.
Well, it does feel less personal, though, than the first one, because the first one is a Jewish revenge story at the heart of it. It's about...
That Indiana Jones doesn't matter in, and we talked about this, where, like, had he not shown up, they wouldn't have even gotten to the treasure, and then when they get that, he's the only survivor, so he doesn't matter, and then they take it away from him.
Mm-hmm.
In this, Indiana Jones is the hero the whole time.
Yeah.
Which is a clear distinction, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so the breath of God, a penitent man will pass, and they do a great thing here, which is the bleeding to death Henry Jones just keeps saying, a penitent man, a penitent man.
They cut back and forth between him and Indiana trying to talk his way through it.
Well, and the neat thing about this is we've established that Indiana Jones doesn't really care.
Mm-hmm.
He's not that he's an atheist, but he is an...
Well, he's interested in the artifact, but he doesn't really care about any of the backstory behind it. Just, this is an ancient thing that carries importance to people. I need it.
And meanwhile, his father is a religious man, and he slaps the hell out of him. He goes, because at one point he says, either Jesus Christ or goddammit or something.
He says Jesus Christ at one point.
And his father slaps him and goes, that's for your blasphemy.
Yeah.
And you're just like,
Oh, that was that was a good Sean Connery read right there.
Oh, thank you. But there is something about his character that says, you're a good person, you need to be better than this.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why he's shocked that he's so willing to murder people, I think. But it's Spielberg. You don't need to say it. There's so many scenes in there where there's almost silence and you get it. And I made this note, which we'll get to at the very end of this act, that really hits the nail home for me. But we should get through these three things. Well, and this is directing magic to me.
Oh, yeah. Well, the second thing is the path of God.
Oh, we didn't even get there. What does the penitent man do?
He kneels.
He kneels before God. And that's why everyone's been decapitated, because these blades come out of nowhere. And I told my wife, I'm ready to see this in HD, because I had an old VHS copy and I had no idea what was happening with the VHS. And in 1080p, you see these blades whip around like an insane, like this is crazy. This is Legends of the Hidden Temple shit here.
Oh, well, that would be the one thing Indiana Jones would never be able to beat us, the Shrine of the Silver Monkey.
Yeah, this guy, I love you, buddy. Then the second thing is the Word of God, which is, there are these letters. This is like a Scrabble nightmare. And he's like, oh, the Word of God, that's Jehovah. And he steps on a J. And you see Sean Connery goes, but in Latin, Jehovah starts with an I.
Now, here's something that confused me about that, which is, Indiana Jones can't have been the only person that tried finding the Grail. We know this because there's all this text that his dad found. So why isn't that thing covered with holes? Why does it look perfect?
Maybe the ancient Crusader knight keeps fixing it.
He's just there with a spatula. He's there with a trowel. I had the same thought. He's like, well, you just hear it in the background.
Oh dear, yet another one.
He's there with like a squeeze bottle of the. He gets the Holy Grail, he dips it in, he's just like, all right, time for another one.
It's not like he really has anything else to do.
No, you're right. I had the same thought. Although we don't know how many people got past Penitent Man.
That's true.
I just love, that's where all the crystal skulls came from. I just go. Although it's funny, I teach AP World and I referenced that the other day. We were talking about Latin and they were like, Juventus, like blah, blah, blah. I'm like, but in Latin, J is an I. And they're like, how do you know that? I'm like, I saw Indiana Jones 3.
Well, isn't that. And this is getting into weird history that might get stuff thrown at me, so feel free to edit this out.
Sure.
Isn't that where Jesus' name comes from? Because in Hebrew, it's Yeshua, but yeah. Because translated to Greek and then translated to Latin, the Y became a J?
Yeah, exactly. Jesus Christ is Greek for Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Messiah.
Well, right. And that's where we had there's.
Well, isn't it Joshua, technically?
Joshua, Yeshua, they're the same thing.
And Jesse and Jesus, they're all the same name. Like, there's actually a lot of people named Jesus. We associate it with it being Latin, like Latin American, like Jesus. But there's actually a lot of Jesus, including a lot of Jews I know named Josh.
Yeah,
there you go. Yeah. But yeah, so he eventually gets past that after nearly falling to his death in the first step.
The point is, this stuff got translated and retranslated into a ton of different languages.
Which is cool. They reference this. Like, again, it would have been, in the way that being Dan Brown's research assistant would be very frustrating, being Spielberg's would be kind of fun.
Well, Dan Brown would be frustrating because you just present him something and it's like, oh, well, that really means this. No, Dan, it doesn't. Well, I'm going to say it means this. God damn it, Dan.
I got another parking ticket. Must have been the Vatican. Oh, the Vatican killed that prostitute. I know. But anyway, from here, we get to the third one, which is a really cool camera trick, which is the leap of faith.
Speaking of HD, it took me a while to figure out what was going on here because I had, you know, the old VHS copy and even the old DVD. I could never tell what was happening because I thought it was like, when I was a kid, a moving platform that you had to essentially jump to hit. But no, it's just this thing that was blended into the rest of the wall.
Yeah, and so he goes, it's a leap of faith. No one could leap this. Oh, God, it's a leap of faith.
Yeah.
And so he just closes his eyes, sticks his foot out from the lion's mouth, and there's a platform there. It's just the pattern of the wall behind it. And they do a camera pan to show that he's on a platform.
Yeah.
And then when he gets to the end, they do a pan underneath, show that he's on a thick platform, and then he throws sand across it. And I don't know who designed these sets, but this sequence alone is a masterpiece. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know. I can look, but I don't know if they won an Academy Award for this. This Ooh. Is all masterpiece.
I'm sure they were nominated. Spielberg usually gets a lot of technical nominations. He didn't win Best Director until, like, 18 years after Jaws.
Lincoln? Schindler.
Schindler's List.
Schindler, yeah. This one, Best Effects. It was nominated for Sound and Music. Because if John Williams is mentioned, he gets three nods.
At least.
Yeah. And Sean Connery won a Golden Globe. That's cute.
And a BAFTA. He was nominated for a BAFTA.
Anyway. Then we meet... what's the actor's name who plays this guy?
Oh, well, according to the Tribune, you're talking about The Knight, right?
Yeah.
It was supposed to be Laurence Olivier, but he was...
Oh, he just died.
Well, when they were filming it, he was, like, too sick to do anything.
They couldn't get him the Grail.
Yeah. Exactly. But he was too sick to actually do anything, so they moved on to... I don't even know what else this guy's done.
Not much. Robert Edison. He had a face that reminded me of someone, but he's not. He was born in 1908 in Yokohama, Japan, and died in 1991. So he was old man.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, he was 700 plus years old.
Yeah, exactly.
Long time to wait.
And so they make this reference that of the three brothers... one had died on the way,
mm-hmm.
And then one had died back in France somewhere, right?
Yeah, after living for like 150 additional years.
And then dying of extreme old age.
Yeah.
And that's the one they had half the tombstone of. And then the mm-hmm. one they found in Venice, of course, had died on the way home. And so we know that you have to drink of the Grail regularly to stay alive.
Yes.
That is established. And that's something that I had missed when I was a kid. But they established that very early on.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have this 800-year-old knight, and he goes, I am the third of three brothers who've pledged an oath to find the Grail. And he goes, that was 800 years ago. You are dressed strangely for a knight.
And of course, the French have already gotten there and locked all the English people out and thrown dung at them.
Yes, exactly.
I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
And he puts down the sword and goes, look, they're bad people. And then that's when Donovan and Ilsa come by.
Yeah.
And then we have a line that my wife knew but had not seen this movie before, which is, he goes, so choose the cup of the Grail, of Christ. Choose the Grail of Christ. The right choice will bring you eternal life, and the wrong one will take it away.
Mm-hmm.
And Elsa thinks she's doing us a solid and chooses the wrong cup.
Was that deliberate?
Yeah, because it cuts to her right at when he drinks from the false Grail. And she set him up. Okay.
Yes, but screw her. I hate her character. This doesn't redeem her. This is a stupid scene to me. I didn't want her here. I wanted him to be cocky and choose the cup that he thinks is the cup of Christ. Because why would she trick him? I don't understand her motivation here.
I guess it's because he shot Henry?
Who cares? She doesn't care about Henry. She sold Henry out. She sold them both out.
Yeah.
Whatever. They choose this gilded cup, and he goes, this is the cup. This is truly the cup of the King of Kings, a reference to Persia for whatever reason.
And Cecil B. DeMille, because this is Spielberg.
That's exactly right. They drink out of the water, and
there's like a baptismal font in the middle of the room that everybody uses to dip cups into.
This reminds me of there's a great Robot Chicken gag, which is that he's been there for 800 years and there's no explanation how he gets food. So he keeps ordering takeout, and that's where all the other cups come from.
That's pretty good.
Well, maybe those Brotherhood of the Sword people are bringing him food.
I mean, that possibly. Makes sense. They're the only ones who would have gotten
Well, if you're before. If you have eternal life, if so long as you're drinking from the Grail, you don't need food, do you?
I would assume you'd still be hungry. I sometimes I'm not hungry, but I'm hungry. You know what I mean?
I had that happen earlier. It's why I ate at Moe's.
Yeah. Welcome to Moe's!
Never mind.
No, please.
That was a comment that, you know, that's how he survived the refrigerator nuking, is because he had drunk from the Holy Grail about 20 years before.
Hey, you know
what? Why not?
That's as good of an explanation as we ever got from Spielberg.
We'll get to that, because we'll get to that.
We'll get to that next week. Regardless, he drinks from the wrong cup.
And then he turns into the crypt keeper.
Yeah.
We did not rehearse that, I promise. No.
That's what came to my mind, too. There's definitely a crypt keeper thing in there.
It is a horrifying scene as he grabs onto Ilsa, screams in her face, and turns to dust.
Oh, my God. What?
Eyeballs sink into his head.
And the skin rots off, like literally rots off.
And his hair grows like super long, crypt keeper-like.
Yeah.
Well, and then the Grail Knight just goes, and he chose poorly. And that was the line my wife knew. She just didn't know where it was from. And he delivers it with such soullessness. Like, it's so just, he doesn't care, such flippancy, that it is perfect.
Yeah.
It's really perfect. And then Elsa goes, and then Indy just
selects another one.
He essentially shoves her out of the side and goes, look, you think you're doing a favor for me. I don't care about you. And he goes, this is the cup of a carpenter. And it's beat rusted up old metal
cup. Although it's kind of got that Pulp Fiction-y thing where there's that glow coming from the middle.
That's a mistake.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm not, that's a mistake they made because they wanted the inside to still look holy, sanctified in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than doing a glowing effect, they still painted the inside with it gold.
Yeah.
And he goes, this is the cup of a carpenter. It wouldn't be gold, and it's still gold inside.
Yeah, exactly.
Whoopsie doodle. So he drinks from it. He doesn't die. And he goes, you've chosen wisely. And they bring the water back. It heals the wound. He does this incredible... help me out, Daniel. It's a Jesus movie. It's Ben-Hur, where he appears in the desert and gives the thirsty man water.
Oh, yeah. Well, isn't that Ben-Hur that he appears to in the desert?
But that's what it is. It's literally Ben-Hur because he's so desiccated he can barely drink the water.
Mm-hmm.
And he's pouring it down his throat, right? Like, it's Judah Ben-Hur. Like, that's the scene from Ben-Hur.
Mm-hmm.
And then he pours it on the wound, and the bullet wound heals off like it's Alka-Seltzer.
Yep.
The Nazis... seeing literal magic are horrified. Sala picks up the gun and orders the rest of them to drop the guns.
Yep. And then, of course, Ilsa picks up the Grail, even though the knight had said, basically, you can't take it from the temple.
Once you go past the gold seal, it will disappear. She gets to the gold seal and he goes, Ilsa, drop it. Don't go, Ilsa. And again, women ruin everything.
Because there's an earthquake and the temple collapses and the Grail... Well, I don't think it gets lost necessarily. It's just sort of hanging there.
Well, okay, so it lands on a little thing. And she practically dives in after it, right? Because it's possibly the most important treasure in Christendom and the idea that it brings everlasting life. But again, this is one of the 1001 Arabian Nights.
Mm-hmm.
Everlasting life comes at a price, which is that you're stuck in this temple.
Yeah.
And she wants to have it both ways. She cannot have it both ways, and therefore...
Now, how does that work? Does it just stop working if you manage to get it out of the temple?
I think the idea is by trying to take it across the seal, it causes the temple to collapse. It's some sort of trap.
But I suppose... the same thought as Daniel, which is that, if you still make it out, you still get to keep the Holy Grail. Right?
Yeah. That's what you were thinking. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If you still get it out, I mean, is it still going to work?
Also, you know what the gag should have been? It's a baptismal font, like you said. If you scoop it in and it turned to wine. If it did the Jesus miracle of turning water to wine.
Ooh.
That would have been
something.
Especially if it wasn't referenced. If it just turned to red wine.
Mm-hmm.
Good gag. Good reference. Anyway, so long story short...
Elsa dies because she falls through that chasm.
Indy's trying to hold on. She slips out of her leather glove, and then Indy falls in after her, because she falls in, and then Sean Connery, as Dr. Jones, grabs it, his hand, and then again, a very effective scene because we've established their relationship, because Spielberg knows how to fucking direct a movie. He goes... Junior, stop. The Grail doesn't matter. He goes, but Dad, I can almost reach it.
He's touching
you.
It. Yeah.
He's literally touching it with his fingertips, and he goes, Indiana, it's not worth it.
Let it go.
Let it go.
Let it go.
God damn it, Matt. We were trying to avoid that.
I know. I'll even do the joke now because you ruined it for everyone. I was watching this with my wife, and I was like, so we have another blonde-haired woman with a foreign accent who wears gloves to protect herself, who is obsessed and possibly the antagonist of her own movie, named Elsa. And we're talking about this back and forth, and then Sean Connery looks right at Indiana Jones and goes, Indiana, let it go. And I'm just like, oh, f- Disney. Oh my god. Oh my god.
Frozen is one of the is probably the most goddamn overrated movie of the 2010s.
I don't know, man. Have you heard that song? Have you heard Let It Go?
Yes.
Would you want to build a snowman?
No.
Oh. Are you sure you don't want to build a snow? I think the movie.
No, Sarah Marshall. I don't want to build your f***ing snowman.
What's the woman from The Good Place?
Kristen Bell.
She's in it, right? Like, yeah. She's a sister. She's fine. I don't hate the movie. I agree with you. It's overrated. I don't hate it like you do. Daniel has a certain place of his heart for the joy of children. And, you know, we can get there later. Anyway.
It could be perhaps that my shoes are too tight.
And someday his heart will grow three sizes.
Well, my doctor's already telling me that's not something that needs to happen.
Unless we have to cut off on the trans fats. But from here, effectively, the Grail disappears, Indiana, and Brody, and Sala.
Yeah, they make it out.
They make it out. The Nazis have, I don't know.
Well, also, Henry sees the knight, which I think is kind of a validation for him and what he had been searching for, too.
Well, I mean, and he gets to touch the Grail, the thing he's looking for his whole life. And also, it's a reminder that if Indiana Jones shows up in your ancient treasure, he's going to destroy everything, because he's there for 20 minutes and there's nothing left.
Well, that wasn't his fault. That was Elsa's fault.
Yeah, but he's waving at Indy. He's not waving at Elsa. He's like, thanks. Hey, thanks. Okay, thanks. Bye. So if you're the knight, you drink from the wrong cup and just end it rather than be trapped alive. And
What does happen to him?
He doesn't have the Holy Grail anymore, so he's got to die soon, right?
I figured the temple just collapsed on him and smushed him.
Yeah, if he survives that, you drink the wrong cup and you just go.
All
right. I mean, you got it, right? There's not a good cup anymore.
Well, you could kind of go get the good cup.
I guess it depends on what happens. We end up with, like, the earthquake ride from Universal Studio where everything shakes, the ground disappears, and we cut. So, anyway.
I like to think he got it back.
I will say this ends as, like, an old, like, John Ford Western, which is kind of great.
Oh.
Because everyone gets on a horse, and he goes, and Brody goes, or follow me, I can get out. And Sean Connery goes, you say he got lost in his own museum. He got lost in the museum. And so they're all trying to chase him down as he's practically falling off his horse like an old soak.
Yep.
And
there's that great shot of them literally riding into the sunset.
Indiana Jones is one of the best created characters in effectively our lifetime, isn't he?
Yeah.
Like, no question. I think I love everything about him. I love, again, that you remove his head. The costume is iconic. Right, like, and that's why Fedora, quote unquote Fedora, is such a great character, because he's wearing the Indiana Jones suit, but he's not Harrison Ford, so it's intentionally designed to be like fingers on a chalkboard.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's like the male model version of Indiana Jones. Like, he's the guy Party City hires.
Oh, that's kind of a slam against Party City. I think Party City at least has some quality control.
But he looks the part. He's wearing a good costume. It's just, it's funny. Like, it's tongue-in-cheek. Anyway, this is the one that was my favorite as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
On rewatch of the three original ones, I liked all of them a lot. I liked Temple of Doom more than I did as a kid. I think Raiders is my favorite of the three, but this one holds up. Daniel, final thoughts?
I think you summarized it very nicely. I watched this one. I seem to remember watching this one more than the other. Well, certainly more than Temple of Doom. I didn't see that till later, but I think more than Raiders as well. And yeah, just, man, yeah. I don't know what else I can add. This is really good.
Matt?
It was all right. I do like a lot of little details they have. Like, for example, the Nazi rally scene, you see there's Himmler and Goering there too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see when they're burning the books, you see Elsa almost start crying because whatever soul she's sold, she's still an academic, and these are books being burned.
Yeah.
So these little character ticks, I really like, even though I don't love this movie like you guys seem to.
Well, I mean, and to your point, like, they go into that political commentary. Like, look, you can disagree with this, but you're still standing with them. Like, he really, like, despises, even though she's an academic and whatever, he hates her for being a part of this, which I think is neat. And he does the same thing with Donovan. Donovan's like, oh, I don't care about the Nazis. I'm going to survive after him. He goes, you're still helping the Nazis. You can't
He was wearing a Nazi pin.
Yeah, he goes, you can't say Nazis are fine and then say they're not fine. Like, he makes that effort.
Wait, you mean you can't do that?
Yeah, I know.
I think we should pass that message along to someone.
Right. I think this movie is really good. It goes back in some ways to not only the core of what Indiana Jones is and them referencing more of James Bond, but like we have the threat constantly. I like the Nazis as the bad guy more than the Maharaja and the Kalima and all that stuff. Not because Kalima is bad, but because he's one guy. Indiana Jones versus the Nazis seems so much more overwhelming, and it seems like he should never have control. So the fact that he stops them means that they still exist, but he's stopping a tidal wave, right? Like, and that's cool. And it's also that he's using what we understand as his knowledge. You know, I'm an Americanist. I'm teaching AP World. And so when we're talking about Asia, I'm like, yeah, I get what I can teach you. I'm a chapter ahead of you in the textbook is the old cliche. Right? That's how the India stuff felt for me. Mm-hmm. He's someone who studies Judeo-Christian stuff. Yeah. And so back here, he feels like he's in his element. And I think that's where he's good. However, next week, he's going to deal with aliens. So as an expert...
Spoilers.
So as an expert in Judeo-Christian and I guess Mesoamerican archaeology... Oh, wait. He's none of those things. Also, the Nazis are gone.
Replaced by...
Soviets.
Galadriel, if I recall correctly.
Correct, Galadriel. Well,
they had the Indiana Jones The Fate of Atlantis video game where it was the Soviets were the bad guys, so it's been done before.
Well, and then the comic books.
And then the TV show where it's like 93-year-old indies just rambling at whoever will listen to him.
Yeah. And I mean, like, and here's the thing about that. First of all, this should not have been an Indiana Jones movie, but not because it shouldn't be a movie. I think it's fine. I have nothing against Crystal Skulls even. Find someone else to play the character. We'll get there.
We'll get there.
So stay tuned next week when we get to The Crystal Skull, and I'll tell you my story how I see that movie. We all will. Mm. We all saw it in theaters.
I certainly did.
Oh,
me too.
It was a deflating breath of bad air.
We'll get there.
Maybe that's why this movie's so good. Because what comes next? So stay tuned next week and every future week as we put another piece of your past on trial. Thanks, guys.
Myopia Defend Your Childhood is hosted by Nick Hoffman, edited by Candace Burns, and executive produced by Nick Hoffman and Candace Burns. It is produced by Daniel Suttis, Matthew Quinn, and Thomas Herman. We are a proud member of the ESO Network and a product of Do Better Podcasting. Our theme is Surf Shimmy by Kevin MacLeod. Find it at incompetech.com. It is licensed under Creative Commons, Attribution 3 license. And thank you.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping through Amazon.com or the TeePublic store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.